is are from the state also, but they can't vote for this election. She's from Cuttingsville. She has a book of poems out called Cloud Train. It was published in 1982. She went to Radcliffe and Harvard, got her MFA in writing from Goddard College, and is right now teaching in the Warren Wilson Master of Fine Arts in Writing program. And without any further introduction, Joan Alshire.
It's nice to be here. I wish I could vote in this election, but I'm glad to live in Vermont that has a town like Burlington that can elect a mayor like Bernie Sanders, and I hope we get out there and do it again. The poems I'm going to read tonight are all really political poems in a way, or public poems. They're poems that I hope talk more about the world than about the self. The poets are always writing about themselves, and I'm trying to look around me a little bit more in these poems. The first one is a poem about their shaved heads gleaming like bullets as blunt. When you were a thickening at my waist, a panic in the mornings, someone in the laundromat observed one November Friday, the president's been shot. Only wounded, I thought first, not knowing our assassins usually take good aim. What world did I bring you into? One you burn to change, hurling yourself at its greed and indifference, at its sparse beauty, these teemogs steaming like the chimneys of all the houses where we've lived. We argue, not protest, but how to make it. Our voice is similar, and our gesture of helping words go where we want. Inherited, like this world, where all that's poised to harvest only succeeds today in drawing us close. So much to be done, the tired trees remind us, rising out of hard-packed dirt, scraping this cheap asbestos roof and the neighbors, as if frantic to be heard. Your nerves and bones lose all their padding, are exposed. We're not supposed to talk. The guards watch from seats by the stove. Someone somehow muttered, here in Temuco, they don't have to use electricity for torture. It's cheaper to let rain do the work. Rain repeating its attack on your head and shoulders. Rains like machine guns, like showers with more power than in New York. Rains that hesitate and raise our hopes, mists that make you feel blindfolded already for the death squad. This rain gets you used to the cold that waits in the grave. When I wrote poems, I wanted to say the world is like this and this exactly. With no pen or paper here, I lose the habit of forming words. The saddest lines for me are thoughts that flood me like rain, indistinguishable one from the others, streaming past and gone. This is a poem about my brother being born. Trying something hard, risking ridicule, wanting to be as calm as the pond seen from a distance. Falling in love, uncertain and clumsy, might be an example, or sometimes just opening your mouth.
Building in the driveway of the house. house next door, and from what I heard downstairs, the guy next door is not really happy about it. So if the person that owns that car and is parked in that driveway can move that vehicle, we'd make somebody else pretty unwanted. Is everything here okay for you? Yeah, I'm going to move this up so you're a little closer. Consult with his notes once more. The next reader, going down the alphabetical list, which was the easiest way for me to organize this, is T. Allen Broughton, the lone native of Burlington, the lone individual who had cast his vote for Bernie Sanders. He's been teaching at UVM for 18 years. He's the author of 4 novels, among them The Horse.
I guess I've kind of declared myself, haven't I? But it is going to be nice to be voting again as a majority. I didn't get a chance to do that last time I went to the polls. To put this in some kind of proper perspective, I do work at UVM, which is a kind of graffiti center. And I was noticing the other day a poster I put up outside my door. It said, "Poets Reading for Bernie." And underneath somebody had written, "What's the matter, he can't read?" So, I'm looking forward to later on this evening. I'd like to just read 2 poems tonight. The first is a narrative poem about a boy and a guide in the woods, and then a shorter poem that follows. This is called Guide. I need a boy to carry wood, serve plates to the dining room. I get too nervous out of my kitchen. Charlie's hands trembled at the thought, ashes from the butt he lifted, dusting his tattered shirt. I rode him up the lake. "You know how to swim?" he muttered. "I don't, never learned. Been up and down this lake so many times, it's all my sweat, but I'm always scared." What did I know of fear? 15, taller than any friends, hated no one. Summer folk we were, but I needed that job. "Here," Charlie said, "I'll dish the soup, you carry it in." My hands were steady. Miss Danforth unrolled her napkin, and her son, older than Charlie, choked up in a striped bow tie, began a story they shared about his father's first trip to the camp. That lasted through dessert. She lived in the basement. We rented the second floor. My mother hired her once to cook for an evening of guests, once to sit in the parlor till late while my father and mother went dancing. I hid by the cracked door of my darkened room and watched her lolling back on our couch, splayed thighs and stockings rolled at her knees. She dozed until I thought she slept, but her head began to rock and she hummed in a gentle moan with her arms crossed over her breast. The slits of her eyes were fixed on me, her song lifting and folding me down, till I woke in the morning curled in a bed that did not seem my own. "Stay out of the basement," my father said. "That's not your home." But our storage bin was there, and spring was time to resurrect bites. The door to her room was ajar. Again, she was humming softly, and when I stood close to the crack, the air wafting out was thick with some sweet rot I did not know, like earth turned up to the sun. I took my bike and pumped 10 times around the block in hot pursuit of thieves, then sprawled on the limber spikes of tulips. Did I search for my bell there, only to hear her again? I could have remembered how I had lost it last summer. But I hid when someone came down the outside stairs, pebbles cracking on concrete. "Bella," he called softly and knocked. "Honey, you there?" What I heard was a snatch of moan, her hum of welcome. Oh, how he laughed when he pushed the door, and I wanted to join him. Quietly over the cindered floor, I carried my hammering heart, kneeled by the wall in that careless crack. sing, and I beat the drum of my headboard hard against the wall until she cried out in unceasing breath that flowed through every room of the house, and I stood up, fearful she had died. When I lie in fever, when stretch of pain of body or untouchable rack of mind screws tight enough to snap me, I think of how I breathed again, how I rolled deep into joy when her low and honeyed humming began again, and the comb of the house grew fat on that single room. The flowers under the cherry trees blazed from their buds, and I could have curled forever in sleep while she rocked the world in her wide arms. Thank you.
Opening night was Bernie threw out the first ball and the lights went out for an hour and a half. I dug out of an old poem that I threw away, an old long poem that I threw away, a section for today called Poet's Fantasy. It's the third batter of the inning, men on first and second, there because of me. The grounders I let through my legs. I am playing second, pulled over halfway to first. The batter is left-handed. He sends a screaming liner over the pitcher's head, headed for the gap in center, 8 feet off the ground. I scramble to my right, soar above the bag, and spear the ball backhanded, and I drop like an eagle landing onto second, seize the ball barehanded, and race toward first, toward the befuddled turning runner. I tag him, then loose boned and cool, I flip the ball toward the pitcher's mound and shamble to the bench, leaving my mates unmoving in their tracks, dumbfounded, incredulous at my unassisted triple play. Gentrification of poetry and poets and art and artists, children and teaching and schools. On my way in from the airport to the Barclay Hotel, which the magazine in my room said is the Philadelphia Prestige Hotel, on my way to marble floors and chandeliers, to elegant food and wine, to all the words about poets and painters, to rich desserts, to meetings about art and teaching and children and schools. On my way in from the airport, I saw a huge black man in an overcoat on a street corner, his back to the street, facing a vacant lot in which there was a pile of bricks and plaster and dirt and cement. And this huge black man was staggering, swaying back and forth, his knees buckled from time to time. And he was standing, you might say, moving in place as if he were marking time to a tune with a bizarre tempo, a tune someone else was forcing him to march to. And this huge black man who was staggering, swaying, standing, you might say, this huge black man who was marking time to somebody else's tune was flailing his arms out in front of himself and throwing punches at that pile of rubble or at someone in front of himself who wasn't there. And this huge black man, I know this, smelled like alcohol and piss. On my way in from the airport to the Barclay Hotel, which the magazine in my room said is the Philadelphia Prestige Hotel, on my way into the meetings about art, I saw a huge black man, and he was shouting and crying. He was crying. I spent the winter writing poems about the relationship between men and women, and I'm going to read some of those poems now. I haven't ever read them in public before. What is this life? morning they throw words at each other, wishing they were plates or stones or knives. They don't want to be heard. They want to wound. They want to hurt each other, cut each other open, watch each other bleed. More and more furiously and more, each slashes at the other until, exhausted, they grow sullen and then silent. And then they fix lunch. They eat, eyes cast down. Then, why? They look into each other's eyes. They come toward each other, reach out, touch each other. They undress each other, and naked and unashamed and, for this moment at least, forgetting the hatred they each has for the other, they lie down together and make an ecstasy with their bodies which is so intense, so completely beyond themselves, that when they are done and exhausted again, and they can think of something other than the ecstasy they have made together, they think of Meister Eckhart saying, empty yourselves of ego. Keep nothing back for yourself. Such a person has everything. For to have nothing is to have everything. Those who thus go out of themselves will indeed be given back their true selves. Envoy to what is this life? Is this the way it happens? Did this ever happen? Or is this only another poet lying? Imagination, dream, poetic fantasy of what will never be. My fingers touch your eyelids. My fingers touch your cheek. My fingers touch your lips. My fingers touch the back of your neck. My fingers touch your shoulders. My fingers touch the flesh around your armpit. My fingers touch the hair in your armpit. My fingers touch your nipples. My fingers touch the softness of your belly. My fingers touch your hips. My fingers touch your hairy pussy. My fingers touch the inside of your thighs. My fingers touch your asshole. My fingers touch the flesh behind your knees. My fingers touch the bottoms of your feet. Death fear. When we couple, when we ride, when we moan and shout, sometimes I know ecstasy. And in those moments, oh, I am so glad that I'm alive. And then the fear of death comes on me. Dialogue. He says, baby, bugs in a bowl. The great and crazy, wonder-filled Chinese poet of 1,000 years ago, Han San, said, we're just like bugs in a bowl, all day going around, never leaving their bowl. I say that's right. Every day, climbing up the steep side, sliding back. Over and over again, around and around, up and back down. Sit in the bottom of the bowl, head in your hands, cry, moan, feel sorry for yourself, or look around, see your fellow bugs, walk around, say, hey, how you doing? Say, nice bowl.
And we had cooks and maids and silver spoon in my mouth. When I was 16 years old, I took it out and I threw it on the floor. And I said, you can take that spoon and you can shove it. See, if I'd been a boy, I would have been the oldest son of the oldest son. Etc. And I would have been named Bruce. But I was a girl. So they let me throw the spoon on the floor. See, if I'd been a boy, they wouldn't have let me do it. But I wasn't so important. Something like that. This is my grandmother's. Isn't it pretty? A little dirty. Was the only thing she gave me. She left my cousins $400,000 each. I don't know when I got it. I think I stole it. You know where I went to school? You wouldn't believe it. I was a very talented artist. I could have been famous. Rosemary June. You never heard of me, huh? Hi.
Hi.
Aren't you cute? You're so cute. I was a pretty little girl like you once. Mm-hmm. I was a little girl, too. And we had a big house and a maid.
Mm-hmm. Isn't she cute?
Come over here, little girl. Come on. I'm not gonna hurt you. I just want to say, come on. I used to be a little girl just like that. And I used to have a pretty little dress like that, with all different color spots and velvet. This is my grandmother's. Isn't that pretty? Oh, this must be your little girl. You must be her mother. Oh, please don't take her away. That's all. I'm not going to hurt her. Please, I used to be a little girl just like that. I'm tired. Yeah, I gotta get some rest. Good night, little girl.
thanks, little girl.
And the Vermont Council on the Arts apparently has helped the Mayor's Council on the Arts a great deal since its inception and since the Mayor's Council on the Arts has taken off in the last few years. So in addition to welcoming Jeff Hewitt for his poetry, we should welcome him for his efforts as an administrator in the arts in this area, Jeff Hewitt.
February sequence. Dawn, with its eyelid of song, sashays in to nudge sleep's elbow. And you waken with a dream, sleep's energy, the unborn child trapped in your skull, that funny bone. Waken to the snow and a wicker rocking chair tipped over by wind. First sunlight, first real shine in 3 weeks. Shadows, startling shadows, and the apple tree, too stiff to shrug, holds its awkward, leafless, haywire, dancing pose. How steady from harvest till spring, that frozen pregnancy. January thaw got some wiseacres, maples, excited, and he tapped them. And words out, he'll be the richest sugar maker this year. A funny thing happened. We had to wait to use the telephones. Too many of us and not enough phones. They had some lieutenants making the connections, and they'd call us into the room when our turn came. The colonel came and called my name, and I heard Jonelle's voice, and she said, "How are you feeling, honey?" And I said, "I'm okay. Baby, I love you." She said, "I can't believe it's really you." A lieutenant tapped me on the shoulder. I had the wrong telephone. I was being welcomed by another man's wife. It was very strange. How simply the movement of my own vision resembles that of every bird, every skyscraper and rock, each bouncing swirl of molecule, the tiny margin of circumstance that keeps me from being a bird or skyscraper or rock. If I do not visit the stars, do not journey below my feet, I don't sustain the glitter of snow scattered by the chickadee's wing. Mind each step a baby takes, rehearsal for a dance, each sound from which he'll learn to make and choose words, each bite that becomes body or energy or thought, or never mind such obvious building of experience. Think instead of arrangements of molecules, learning his habits, becoming him. They pile up and say, "Hi." These are very short poems. This is called Good Company. It's a haiku. Between Hemingway and Homer, you'll find my books at better bookstores. A delicacy. This morning for breakfast, I had honey-covered ants. Tasted like honey with ants in it. And Ben carries the cracked egg. Ben was 4 years old at the time. He's my son. He calls me by my first name. This one's for you, Jeff. I think they'll lay my egg tomorrow. In sadness, I started for a place I had hoped to avoid, a place I branched away from 10 years earlier, had to retrack. 10 years of backtracking. I hated myself for the 20 years I had wasted, until at the source of my sadness, I realized the only years wasted were those spent hating myself. Loving myself for that discovery, I forgave the years spent hating. Blithering proud, I stumbled down the same wrong path again. Missing his name in the snow, got Geo of George completed before he ran out of steam, and simply added the F of his middle name as a dribbling flourish. He later admitted he'd been possessed of the arrogance to have intended pissing his whole name, including Frederick, and the abbreviation for Junior. Admiring his yellow shorthand in the snow, he saw a new way to spell Jeff and rescued triumph from apparent defeat. This is my political poem of the evening. The politics come in the last two lines. It's a fairly long poem, so bear with me, but you can phase in and out of it. It's very narrative. It just tells a little backwards story. And I'll tell you the political part has to do with the fact that the poem was written shortly after Ronald Reagan was first elected to be president of the United States, and it struck me that he was at the age of retirement. Introduction. Let me introduce to you the concept of backwards evolution. But first, an aside. Words backwards tell a lot about themselves. Radar backwards is radar, a one-word palindrome. Backwards is straw cab. And get this, embargo backwards is oh grab me. Catatonic is cannot attack. And revolution is no shoe lover. I can say whole sentences backwards without prior consideration. Accurate unless you work one up ahead of time to trick me. Language loved and played with like a child reveals itself. Backwards evolution, by the by, holds simply that our entire perception of cause and effect is merely reversed. Think about it. Effect and cause. Effect then cause. Meanwhile, our memories are upside down because provably at birth we reach up when we should reach down, meaning our vision has to be trained. And so I have no prophetic vision, but say it all starts in the future as we see it, with a big bang, the sun-like energy, the God that sets us spinning, and we evolve to this day, each of us growing younger. It as it goes from green to whatever color they are before then? Meanwhile, presidents and kings are unwaging wars and back away from their jobs, which fall into the laps of those who are ready to retire. Wrestling to lose.
First, because it's a campaign, I'm obliged to make you a campaign promise. And this campaign promise, however, is contingent upon two factors. First, I have to be reelected. And second of all, we need a seventh person on the Board of Aldermen. If we get that, this is what I promise. And it's something, in fact, that I've wanted to do for 4 years. I don't believe that politics should be separated from life. I mean, the reason that nobody votes, the reason that nobody goes to the Board of Aldermen's meetings is they're deadly. And in point of fact, far more truth and honesty is portrayed here tonight than probably in 10 Board of Aldermen meetings combined. Because even in our Board of Aldermen's meetings, one of the redeeming factors is there's a lot of hatred. And hatred in itself is not necessarily bad. But this hatred is not even honest hatred. So what I promise, and I mean this very, very sincerely, is one of the things that we try to do is combine different things. And I think what government is about, what democracy is about, is life. It's all component, all aspects of life. And a funny thing, you know, some of our opponents get very angry. Doreen Kraft is very often attacked. They've written editorials about Doreen Kraft. Why are they attacking Doreen and the Council on the Arts? They get very angry that on a Thursday night, 1,000 people will come to Battery Park, look at a beautiful view, the lakes and the mountains, and enjoy a concert. They get very, what does this have to do with government? Why are you spending taxpayers' money for 1,000 people to come together to enjoy Vermont, to enjoy each other? How dare you do this? And the Free Press writes editorials, and it's considered to be a terrible thing, because that's not what we should be doing. We should be doing something else, and we shouldn't be having kids come together and learn and grow. And in point of fact, what I would love to see, I really would, we would like to see music at Board of Aldermen's meetings. Absolutely. It is not a separate thing. The idea that these things are separate, poetry at Board of Aldermen's meetings. Sometimes one does see honesty. And it's a funny thing. I want to talk a little bit about art and politics. The sad part about politics is much of it is very, very dishonest. And the media, I think, creates that to a large degree. One cannot be honest on television if you're getting 17 seconds on the tube. It cannot be done. Sometimes one sees honesty in politics. One saw it a couple of nights ago at a meeting that we had in City Hall dealing with our electric rates. And what one saw is a number of people coming forward very honestly and straightforwardly telling Public Service Board, which was not particularly interested, that they are very poor, that they are living in houses that they cannot afford to eat, some in tears, not knowing what to do, an elderly man of 80 years old saying that he can't pay his electric bill because he doesn't have enough money to buy his food. And there was honesty and some tears and some emotion. And that was real. That was true. Often we don't see that. The basic truth of politics is primarily class struggle, where some people own and get rich off other people's labor. Since I have been involved in politics, I have not heard one person get up there and defend the fact, get up and say, I am in business because I want to make a lot of money, and to hell with everybody else. That's never said. People go into business to create jobs, to provide a tax base for us all. And one does not see honesty. I mean, I would much prefer, to some degree, I mean, one thing that Reagan has done, and I have to grant him this, he's much more honest and straight, but no more quibbly, we want to invade Nicaragua. We don't like the government there. Hey, that's all right. That's it. We don't like it. We should invade it. Overthrow the government. I mean, it's a very honest, straightforward statement. I am very envious of poets because they have the opportunity to do that what many of us who are in politics often cannot do, and that is be honest and say things that come from the heart. It seems to me that what one wants to do, and an area that I have been interested in for many years, is the whole concept of energy. I am one of those people who believes that civilization is probably on the wrong track. Computers have their place, although in City Hall they seem to slow us up. We're thinking of undergoing a second computer revolution and get rid of them all. We used to have this guy sitting there who looked like Scrooge. And he worked for the city treasurer's office for 28 years. And he used to sit there writing, and actually things got done on time. We have now revolutionized City Hall, spent hundreds of thousands of dollars on computers, and nothing ever happens on time anymore. I don't know. The other thing about politics and art and honesty is you get punished very severely for being honest. You really do. And some thoughts, as I was sitting here listening to the poets tonight, came back to my mind. One remembers, remember Edmund Muskie? Remember Muskie from Maine? Mm-hmm. That name is not on our lips very much anymore. And his political career, or so it is alleged, was destroyed when his wife, I believe, was attacked by our old friend William Loeb. Remember that in Maine? He was running for president. And he was very dismayed. He couldn't deal with it finally. And he stood up there in Manchester, not Manchester, but in New Hampshire, speaking of Manchester, New Hampshire, Manchester, New Hampshire. And the man was so upset that he cried. And there went his whole political career. Because we all know that no president or potential president who is capable of crying is a strong enough person to lead this nation. Right? We all know that. So Muskie cried, and there went his political career. And that's a very sad thing, obviously, because sometimes even political leaders get sad and depressed. Hard to believe. Not at the 6 o'clock news. You're not allowed to do that. Who would ever see the President of the United States, man, it's a shitty day. I am feeling very depressed today. I have to tell you, you know, it's not allowed to exist. So, of course, people who become quote-unquote leaders are not allowed to be human beings and become robots and say the same thing over and again. And you get punished very severely, maybe irreparably, if you don't become that. It's a tough line to hope. I think also what I would like to see, when I mentioned earlier bringing art into politics, is to develop honesty. It is not inappropriate for political people to talk about love or hate or death or sexuality. That really should not just be the province of poets. It'd be an interesting debate on the Board of Aldermen. Where is? Very good idea. Maybe we'll have one of the aldermen introduce this resolution at the next Board of Aldermen meetings. We'll see how the Democrats respond to this. I think one of the things that motivates me in politics and always has is this concept of energy. Is if one gets down, politics is many things. For example, everybody here, I think, would agree that you need certain objective things. People are entitled to decent jobs, to be treated with respect. People are entitled to decent housing. It is basically insane to spend $275 billion on the military when people are starving to death. Those are the easy things. To understand where things are right and things are wrong. But then you get deeper than that and you say, okay, what is really important? You know, what really is important about life? And you know, sometimes you see it very clearly, especially in little children. You see the kids with the red cheeks and the sparkling eyes. And you say, hey, that's really something. This is really this life, this movement, this energy. And I used to work with kids when I was in my previous life. And there's a lot of joy, of course, in working with little children and to see their honesty and their spontaneity. And it is depressing as you get older. And this evening has been a nice evening because that's, of course, what poets are about. It is depressing as you get older, and especially as you hang around political people, how rare that is and how to what degree politics is such an absurd and stupid and dreadful chess game. I mean, we deal with things where there's not the slightest shred of honesty. The game is you say certain things because the TV camera is on. Maybe you can suck the other guy to make a counter move, which will be a mistake. Campaigns are run on that basis. This is a very, very depressing phenomenon. In any case, to me, what's important, and I think the goal that we have to strive for, is not just dealing with the abolition of poverty and war and so forth and so on, but is trying to create a society where people can live fully, where energy can move, where people are not emotionally constipated, which is very often the case. Politics, to me, is very much, as it goes on in the society, and I see this more and more, has got to be looked at as a very irrational. The irrationality, I used to think it was maybe 50-50, 50% economic greed and 50% basic insanity. I am now moving more to the basic insanity aspect of it. The greed certainly is there, but more and more one sees the irrationality, the pathetic, I think the interpretation of why people go to war. Spending billions of dollars more in the military has got to be understood from human frustration and anger and maybe a willingness for death. Maybe there is a strong movement to see the world blown up because the suffering in some ways is too intense. And that's a hard thing if you deal with that. I think there probably are significant numbers of people who want to die. That's really what they want. So when you argue against war, you're arguing against people who really want war. And that's very hard to convince people that actually life is worth living. I think to the degree that we do good things for people and people enjoy living. There was a poem tonight, I think, that dealt with that, actually. That's right, Fuck You, Death. That was what it was about. And if we can create a society where people are feeling reasonably good about life, they will not be quite so desirous, I think, of marching off to war or putting billions of dollars into the military when people aren't living. And not write this poem. Unlike the other authors here, whose books you can pick up in good bookstores, you can't even pick up my books in bad bookstores. No bookstores. But it's a poem by Dylan Thomas, my brother, who I am deeply indebted to for introducing me to books and to many other things, poetry. Older brothers have a difficult time, especially when your parents are not terribly well-educated, as my parents were not. They didn't bring books into the house. And my brother, and it's remarkable how somebody does that on his own. I don't know how he did it. But he himself gravitated toward books and to poetry and to politics and brought books into the house, and he explained some of them to me. So I'm deeply indebted to my brother. And he brought in the poetry of Dylan Thomas and the works of Sigmund Freud and all these other things that influenced me. And he also got a record. It was a beautiful record. Maybe some of you might remember it. Dylan Thomas reading his own poems at the Child's Christmas in Wales. I don't know if people remember that. And it was very beautiful. And there's a poem, and it's a poem that I remember from many, many years ago. And it's part of a theme. It's human beings rebelling, in a sense. Standing up, fighting death, fighting the elements, whatever it may be. So let me read this poem, which I'm sure many of you are familiar with. Do not go gentle into that good night. Old age should burn and rave at close of day. Rage, rage against the dying of the light. Though wise men at their end know dark is right, because their words have forked no lightning, they do not go gentle into that good night. Good men, the last wave by, crying how bright their frail deeds might have danced in a green bay, rage, rage against the dying of the light. Wild men who caught and sang the sun in flight and learned too late, they grieved it on its way, do not go gentle into that good night. Brave men near death who see with blinding sight, blind eyes could blaze like meteors and be gay, rage, rage against the dying of the light. And you, my father, there on the sad height, curse, bless me now with your fierce tears, I pray. Do not go gentle into that good night. Rage, rage against the dying of the light. Thank you.
For his help in setting the place up tonight. Thank again, Joan Elshire, David Budfield, Alan Broughton, Jeff Hewitt, Lisa Reeford, and Bernard Sanders for being here and presenting their crafts to us. And good night.